talk about the electronic payment systems. We said that in any commercial transaction, payment is an integral part for the goods supplied, and there are four types of payments which may be made in e-commerce. The most common one in customer to business, that is or B2C, you might say B2C commerce, is the credit card payment. And that is what where we will spend a fair amount of time, because it's an interesting type of encryption we have to do, and there are some new standards which have come up, and I'll have to discuss that in some detail to be able to talk about the credit card payment. And apart from the credit card payment, there are three other payment techniques. One is check payment, and I told you last time what the analogy is in terms of when you go to a shop, you can pay by check also, if provided they trust you. So in B2B e-commerce, check payment is more common. Of course, cash payment is normally for small amounts, and the cash, the greatest value of cash from the point of view of a shopkeeper and a customer is that one doesn't have to authenticate cash. Cash that doesn't require any further authentication, provided of course the currency notes and all are not really fake, which is normally not the case. One other important thing about cash is anonymity. That is, anybody can give cash. And when you give cash to a customer, to a shopkeeper, he doesn't note down the numbers of your currency note which you gave, because that will be too difficult and it will too time consuming. So normally they will not do that. I mean, they just take it. Anybody who tenders cash, the cash has the same value. So it is anonymous. Who paid it, if you ask him, he will not be able to know. So anonymity is one of the greatest assets of cash payment. That's what governments are worried about, anonymous payments through cash, because it can be for all kinds of illegal purposes also. Okay. And of course, lastly, it is small change payments. Small change payments for things like, you know, getting a few pages of a book, copy of that, or downloading one music track from an album, things like that, which don't require too much of money to transact, but then it's a small change. But then each transaction cost must be quite low, so that the transaction cost must be much lower than the cost of actually transacting the business. In other words, the smaller the change, the one would ideally have a situation where smaller the change, less is the amount of computer time and other overheads you spend. But by and large, it turns out that the regardless of the amount of time spent by the machine would be the same. But they normally would put some kind of a lower bound below which you cannot really go. Okay. So these are the four types of payments we are really talk about, and today I will start talking about the credit card payments, because as I said, in B2C commerce, it is the most common kind of a methodology which is used for payment. Now let us just look at the way in which the manual credit card payment goes on. When you go to a shop and offer a credit card, what are the steps which are carried out? The reason we would like to kind of look at that is, in the electronic commerce world, the same steps are actually mimicked, or you try to make an analogy of the same steps in the computer world, you might say. But there is a there is some significant differences which will come out when we talk about the manual credit card payment versus the payment on the internet, because internet the payments are anonymous, in the sense that anonymity, in the sense that the customer's face is not seen by the shopkeeper, the shopkeeper's face is not seen by the customer. The shopkeeper or the seller may have only web presence, and the customer may be really transacting business from even a cyber cafe. Okay, he may not own a machine of his own. So there is a lot of difference, because you don't really have an opportunity to see the customer. Similarly, the customer does not have an opportunity to see the shopkeeper. So this is this creates an extra security concerns when you come to electronic world. So in a credit card payment, normally four parties are involved. One is the customer who has a credit card. See, the customer who has a credit card is the one who tries to use it in a shop, the merchant who accepts the credit card. And a merchant normally will accept credit cards from many credit card companies. The most common ones in India are Visa, MasterCard, American Express, and so on. There are number of them. And when you go to a shop outside, they will have a notice saying that we accept Visa and MasterCards and Bank of America cards or whatever, or American Express cards or whatever. There are a number of different agencies which have an agreement with the shopkeepers, and of course they also give you a credit card which is with their own emblem and so on. And they normally, the cash is collected by a bank. There is a bank has an agreement with the credit card company, and for instance, State Bank of India, the cards are Visa cards. If you go to Canara Bank, the Canara Bank has got MasterCard as their partner. So different banks will have different partners, or in fact Visa may have more than one bank as its customer, and the bank is primarily the intermediary who will collect the cash on behalf of the credit card company, and then remit the credit card company with that cash. Of course, there is a certain amount of commissions and so on, which are agreed to between the two. And there is called an, there is another party called an acquirer, which is again an intermediary, which is a financial institution that establishes an account with a merchant. In other words, the merchant, as I said, may deal with more than one credit card company. In other words, he may accept Visa, MasterCard, American Express, and so on. So the bank only issues one credit card company's cards. So the acquirer is somebody who has an arrangement with several credit card companies and also have arrangement with banks. So the acquirer is called an acquirer. It's a financial institution, maybe a bank, one bank, which establishes an account with the merchant, validates credit card information sent electronically by merchant, and authorizes sale. For instance, a particular merchant may have an arrangement with, say, ICICI Bank or Bank of Baroda or whatever it is. Even if I, as a customer, go and present a Visa issued by SBI, the merchant will accept it, but he will transact business with the, in this case, acquirer, which may be another bank. And the acquirer is an intermediary, you might say, between the merchant and the credit card company and the issuing bank and the customer. All four are somewhat involved in the loop. Okay. And so acquirer is a financial institution that establishes an account with the merchant, validates credit card information sent electronically by merchant, and authorizes sale. In other words, the that is a nodal point as far as the merchant is concerned. Acquirer accepts credit cards in several card companies, as I pointed out, and guarantees payments to merchants. So, as far as the merchant is concerned, he makes a credit card sale, and provided that sale is okayed by the acquirer, then the acquirer guarantees that the payment will be made to the merchant. It will not renege on that payment. And the acquirer, of course, gets reimbursed by the bank issuing the credit card. So, there is a and the bank in turn will collect from the customer. Okay, so there is kind of a complex loop which goes on. Now the steps, manual steps which take place when a customer presents a credit card after a purchase, merchant swipes. What he will do is that he will create a little slip with the, in other words, the amount will be essentially, what he does is there is a special data terminal in the merchant shop. It is like a telephone terminal and it is connected by a private line to the acquirer, so that he does not normally use the public switched telephone network. It is a very special kind of a telephone like instrument with a keyboard and also a place on which the credit card can be swiped. So, what he will do is he will swipe the credit card, enter the amount, and this will go to the bank, and the bank will say accept if the credit is good. But, so, the accept will be kind of printed on that slip, and the slip also will have the amount of purchase and what all you purchased. So, there is a listing of items which you purchased, the total amount which you have been charged, and it has been okayed, accepted by the acquirer, and then he asks you to sign that particular. So, merchant swipes it on a special card, enters the amount, data from from the merchant's terminal, data goes to acquirer. And acquirer checks the issuing bank, the validity of the card and the credit available. So, credit availability the acquirer will not know, because ultimately the card which is issued to the customer may be by a different bank. So, acquirer authorizes sale if all okay. Now, if it gets okay from the bank issuing the credit card, it authorizes sale and sends approval slip which is printed in the merchant's terminal. So, it says approved. And merchant takes customer signature, physical signature on that slip. He takes a physical signature, and normally he is supposed to compare that signature which you put on that slip with the signature in the credit card. The credit card itself has got at the back of the card a small place where you are supposed to sign. So, that signature is there. So, these two signatures are compared by the merchant. Just to authenticate that the card really belongs to the person who brought that card. So, the signature comparison is, of course, in the somewhat cursory, I might say. In other words, it is not all the detail like maybe a bank will do if you supply, if you withdraw a lot of cash. But it is nevertheless some kind of a comparison of the two signatures. And if, because you have signed it in his presence, so unless you are an expert forger, that you will not be able to exactly reproduce what is in that card. So, if you sign it in his presence, he understands that you are the legal card owner and he accepts that particular payment from you, okay, and gives you the goods, okay. If he suspects any kind of forgery and so on, he will not give you the goods, and he will intimate instead the acquirer that this card is probably stolen or whatever it is, if he suspects. Okay, but that is entirely up to the merchant. By and large, in my experience, the merchants kind of trust the customer, particularly the customer is a regular customer, or if the customer looks okay and things like that. Now, in any case, it is a duty of the merchant to kind of take the signature and compare it, because later on there is any dispute about the sale, about the amount and the quality of the goods also, then there is a sign receipt which is available with the customer, and a copy of that is available with the merchant. So both of them have got that authenticated signed copy, and that signed copy can be a legal document on based on which one can probably take legal action if it's called for. Okay, the acquirer pays the money. Of course, later on, the acquirer will pay the money to the merchant and collects it from the appropriate issuing bank. The bank sends monthly statement to the customer and collects outstanding amount. That is, ultimately, say, as far as the customer is concerned, the convenience for the customer is that he doesn't have to pay cash for every transaction. So, at the end of the month, the total purchases made throughout the month, that is consolidated into one particular statement, and that statement is sent by mail to the customer, by email or by postal mail or courier or what have you. And the customer is given certain number of days, 10 days, 15 days, whatever, to settle the payment with a check. You send it to the bank, which issued the credit card. Also, the credit card company's name, reason why it's called credit card is because even if you say purchased about 12,000 rupees worth of items in a particular month, and you may not have 12,000 ready cash to pay, then they will say they will pay minimum 1,200 rupees or whatever. Okay, and the rest of it is a credit in your account up to a certain credit limit, which he allows, and then on that credit, very steep interest rates are charged. What I mean by very steep is that the interest rates are something like 2.5% a month, which is a very, very high interest rate. And that's the money on which the banks survive. In other words, the entire transaction and the amount of money spent by the bank in doing all this and maintaining the accounts, maintaining everything, is normally required from the people who are the ones who take a debt from the credit card from the bank indirectly at a very high interest rate. And that is a kind of, if you don't keep a large outstanding, then you don't pay any interest at all, you just clear your amount every month. But of course, every year they charge you something for the privilege of having a credit card. That is, this is a yearly subscription you have to pay to the issuing bank, which will essentially pay for their overheads or whatever they have done for you. Okay, but by and large, the point I'm trying to make is that the convenience is there for the customer, and so the credit limit is also there, and the payment is made periodically by the customer as and when the bill comes. And so you have a certain kind of period or cushioning period during which you essentially have free credit, maybe almost a month sometimes, because the billing cycle is 1 month, and if you buy in the early part of the month, then of course the whole month you are not paying, and you are given certain number of days of grace later on. So the point I am trying to make by and large is that the credit card has got its own value from the point of view of having some credit, also convenience of being able to pay at any given time. But you have to also remember that if you are not able to pay in time, you pay a steep interest rate. So I put down this block diagram. So various steps. First step is customer purchases items and presents a credit card. And the credit card is swiped by the merchant and goes to the acquirer. The acquirer, step 3, checks with the bank whether the credit card has got an appropriate credit limit, balance and so on. And okay, the issuing bank tells the acquirer. Acquirer in step 4 tells the merchant it's okay by printing approved on that slip. And then the merchant in step 5 takes your signature and gives you the goods, and in step 6 of course the issuing bank will send you the monthly bill, and so you have to pay for that at that time. So you have various steps involved in things. Similarly, when the bill is sent, even before, normally depends upon what kind of agreement the acquirer has with merchant. The acquirer also will not pay the merchant instantaneously. They will probably accumulate the whole month's charges from the merchant. At the end of the month, the cash, the check equivalent of whatever has been sold will be credited to the merchant's bank account. Okay, so step 6 sometimes may happen simultaneously. That is, my merchant gets monthly payment and you get a monthly bill. So this is a manual transaction. Now currently in India and also many countries, security of payment of credit card through credit card on the internet is not all that all that secure. Security is not all that good. There have been many instances of credit card numbers being stolen by hackers and so on. And so new types of protocols are coming up, and to the best of my knowledge, these new protocols are not yet being implemented in many countries, including India, because it requires a fair amount of basic infrastructure requirements, and that basic infrastructure requirements are not yet in place, and that also costs both money as well as a certain amount of extra paperwork and so on. So I will first very quickly talk about the current method which people use, in the sense that when you go to your terminal and you carry out a credit card transaction after you make some purchases from a e-shop on the internet, this is the steps you go through. You log on to the vendor through his URL, okay, and request an e-transaction. Okay, so when you require an e-transaction, in other words, you are going to purchase something, you request a transaction. When you request a transaction, he will ask you to use secure line, because the credit card number which you are going to reveal should not go through a public switch telephone network in an unencrypted form, in other words, insecure method. If it is not encrypted and sent as it is, you are exposing yourself to snooping by a whole lot of hackers. If they get hold of your transmission, they look at the transmission, they can immediately kind of get your credit card number. So normally you are asked to send through a secure link. It's called the it's a secure link. I'll call it just a secure link. Okay, and the vendor sends this public key to the customer. In other words, when he asks you to send the use the secure link, effectively he is also sending in some form this public key, you might say. Customer types his credit card number and purchase order on the internet terminal, requests secure transaction. When secure transaction is requested, the system encrypts with vendor's public key this transaction. In other words, the credit card number and the transaction are all encrypted in the vendor's public key, because you know the customer does not have either private key or a public key. He only has his web presence. As I said, the customer may be from logging in from a cyber cafe, and he may not have his own personal computer at home. Okay, so it's a question of, there is no question of any particular combination of public and private and so on at this stage, because customers normally do not have a private and public key, okay, as of today, right? So the merchant has a public key and a private key. There is a minimum requirement as far as the vendor is concerned in order to be able to do a e-transaction. If he doesn't have that, then of course he is exposing the customer to a hacking and exposure of credit card numbers. But one would expect that the vendor has some, when he says secure link, it's an encrypted link. Okay. And system encrypts using vendor's public key. Vendor decrypts with his private key. Okay. And finds credit card number plus order plus amount. So the credit card number and what all was ordered, and the amount is found out by the because he can decrypt it. And once he gets that, he encrypts it with the acquirer's public key, the credit card number and an amount. Okay. And this goes to the acquirer by again secure link. And the acquirer will decrypt it using his private key and find the credit card number plus the amount of order, and it compare it with credit. What is the credit which is there? Okay. Find credit card number and amount of order. I should really say amount of order. Okay. And what is the credit requirement of the customer? Acquirer encrypts credit card number and amount to the bank. Okay, because acquirer does not know the credit status of the particular customer, because it may be a issuing bank or something else. And the bank will give an authorization provided the customer's credit limit is okay and the amount ordered is well within the credit limit. And approval is in turn sent to the vendor for the transaction by the acquirer. Okay, so in other words, in some sense, it's actually mimicking the same steps which take place in manual thing, except that in this case it turns out that the step about physical signature is not there. Okay, physical signature of the customer is not there. The customer's credit card number of course is there, and so the checking, if it is, you know, stolen credit card and anybody masquerades as the customer uses the credit card number, stolen credit card number on the internet, the merchant has no way of really finding out whether it is a stolen credit card or a legal credit card. It may not even be a stolen credit card, it may be a credit card number hacked by somebody. And of course, it is very important for the, in this case, as you can see, the credit card number is available with the vendor, and if he doesn't securely store it, if it stores it in some careless way in his database, because he has to store it at least temporarily till he gets the amount. And normally, of course, he also may have to store it for a longer period in case there is some kind of a dispute later on. And for dispute resolution, he has to have the credit card number, the order and the amount. Okay, so at least he knows when the credit card number is presented, what date it is presented, how much is the order, and what is the order for, and how much is the amount charged. All these things may be required for a later reference. So if suppose these are stored in some kind of a database without encryption by the vendor, he is exposing himself to hackers who can steal the credit card number from his database and use it for transactions. In fact, this actually happened. This situation happened in some companies abroad, to the best of my knowledge. It's kind of, it has been reported in the newspaper, it has been reported in various magazines and so on. And lot of people lost their credit card numbers. The result that number of different credit card companies had to reissue whole lot of credit cards. When they reissue whole lot of credit cards, the huge amount of overhead which they had to take, and so they sued the vendor for having exposed all these credit card numbers. And in fact, in this particular case, the vendor went out of business because he just couldn't pay for all the losses incurred by the credit card company and so on because of his carelessness. So it's extremely important to be able to, because normally The credit card number need not be really known by the vendor, see. So, there shouldn't be any exposure by him, because he should not really even know it. But it turns out that as of now, there is a way which goes on. So, those of you who are interested about all types of these kinds of security lapses which have taken place and situation in real life where lots of what I would say thefts have gone on the internet and so on, there is a magazine called Communications of ACM. Communications of ACM is ACM is Association of Computing Machinery USA, and this particular journal comes every month, and it's very interesting for all of you students to kind of go through that journal, because they've got a number of interesting case studies and so on of information systems which have been implemented, and many, of course, many other technical articles which appear in that, and it's a very, it gives you up-to-date information and what really goes on in terms of the state of the art. There are a number of other interesting type of articles like legally speaking and so on. There is one column at the end of that every month issue. There is one page called Inside Risks. Inside Risks is written by various people, and they have written many different situations or cases where the stealing or security lapses took place on the internet, and because of that, a large amount of money was actually lost by some company or other. Primarily, lot of the money which is lost is by banking companies, and they don't normally reveal it because they reveal the bank has been losing money by theft, because it is not a good publicity for them. But by and large, they will not give the name of the bank, but they will say that this kind of situation occurred. So the inside risk column is a very interesting kind of column or page to read, to kind of admire you are doing anything related to security. At least you know what are all the loopholes which the cleverer hackers seem to be using to kind of break whatever system you make. So it's an interesting kind of a column where a number of these things have appeared, and very interesting stories have appeared about situations where credit card numbers are stolen. Okay, so that is what I would say, the current method. That's why many people are not very much they're afraid of revealing the credit card number on the net. Okay, and but then of course there are, depends on the person. Okay, there are people who take risks. As long as the amount is not very large, you don't mind. But then of course if you lose your credit card number, then that can be very, very bad, because somebody can just go ahead and wipe out your entire credit limit. Okay, and so one has to be somewhat wary about it. So many people kind of try to say that they will pay on delivery, and rather than reveal the credit card number and so on. Okay, so this is one situation which is currently there. So the main problems which we have pointed out in the credit card transaction is, a merchant, merchant has only got a web presence. A customer needs to be reassured the merchant is actually genuine, because an e-shop is on the internet. Whether, in a physical shop, when you go to a shop, you know there is an address, and later on there is a dispute with him, you can go to the address and you can then complain and so on, and you have his phone number and what not. In the e-shop, the only thing you have is a URL, web presence is the only thing. Okay, so he has to reassure the merchant is actually genuine, and customer signature cannot be physically verified, as I pointed out. And the customer needs electronic signature. If he really wants to have a secure transaction, equivalent of physical signature must be there in the electronic signature form. We did talk about signing. We talked about encryption. We talked about how transactions are signed on the internet. Primarily, signature means the customer has got a private key of his own. So, signature implies a private key, public key combination, which must be there with every customer and similarly every vendor. And the vendor's public key should be verifiable, and verification normally takes place through the certification authority. So, certification authority actually gives a okay for the public key of the vendor, then the verification authority's responsibility is to make sure that the vendor who is an e-shop is not a phantom vendor, that is, he does really exist and he does have a legal, he is in fact a legal entity, and legal entity can means that he can be, if there is any kind of a dispute, he can be sued in a court of law. All these things are implied by means of this this public key certification, which is given by the certification agency. So customer also requires the private public key. Signature of credit card number has to be ensured. That is, as I said, if the vendor gets hold of credit card number and he carelessly handles it, then you are exposing yourself to a risk. Okay. So dispute settlement mechanism must be worked out. What do you mean by dispute settlement? Is suppose you tell tomorrow that for whatever I bought, he overcharged me. Or suppose whatever I bought, yeah, after all, you buy without seeing the item, because you order by the by internet, so the item has not been seen by you. If it's something like a ticket, there is no question of quality of the ticket. But if it is a sari which you bought, or if you bought some other item like a dress, okay, then of course the quality is important. All right. So there could be a dispute settlement problem. In other words, he might say that as advertised, the quality is not the same when you supplied it. So then there could be a dispute. So there should be a dispute settlement mechanism which must be in place, which both in terms of the amount charged versus the quality and so on. You must have a freedom to return some item which you are not satisfied, and get reimbursement for the items returned. So all these things are implied by the dispute settlement mechanism. So there is something called a secure electronic transaction protocol, which has really been standardized only recently, maybe a couple of years ago, and it has been standardized by cooperation between several credit card companies, like major companies like Visa, MasterCard, American Express and so on. So all these different card companies got together and they said that we need a standard which is accepted, used by everybody. Okay. And it's called Secure Electronic Transaction Protocol, and as usual, the abbreviation is SET Protocol, SCT, S for Secure, E for Electronic, T for Transaction, SCT Protocol or SET Protocol. It is assumed that in order to be able to apply this protocol, it is assumed that each party involved in e-commerce transaction has a public and a private key. And that means every customer and every vendor has a private key, public key pair. And this is, you might say, too much to ask, particularly for customers. See, vendor, of course, there are not that many vendors, but customers can be millions of customers. So to expect every customer to have a private key is a little too much. But then I think that the protocol really expects that. And maybe if you are continuously transacting on the internet, and you are making large purchases on the internet, large amounts, and then then if you want to use SET protocol, it would be very advisable from your own safety point of view to use this protocol because it is a lot more secure than the protocol which I talked about earlier. So even though the protocol requires this, and also the protocol itself is very complicated, okay, it is, as I said, it is not for everybody that is going to use that set protocol. It is for customers who make very large transactions, see, and also a large number of transactions, okay. So I don't really know when it will really come to effect in general. See, it may be long way off, but it's interesting the way in which the set protocol has been approached, because the points which they make are very important to remember. Okay. So the all parties must have their public key certified, including the customer. He must have his public key certified so that he is actually an physical entity with a certain public key, is known to the vendor also. See, so vendor also is transacting business with a not a phantom customer who will disappear tomorrow, but with a customer who is actually has got a physical presence also. Okay, so that is what is important as far as the reason for public certification of customer's public key also. A standard hashing algorithm is used to create, because signature, actual digital signature requires hashing, which I pointed out. There is message digest, and we talked about the MD5 product from RSA, which does a hashing, and it's a reasonably good hashing function, so that two distinct documents will hash to two distinct digests, and the digest will will authenticate the original document. Okay, and so standard hashing algorithm is used to create message registers for signature verification. So as I said, MD5 is currently one of the standards which is used. The main features of the secure electronic transaction protocol is that customer's credit card number is not revealed to the merchant. Merchant does not have to know the credit card number of the customer. He needs to only know what the customer wants to purchase, the items he wants to purchase, and of course the total amount he is going to charge. Only these two are required. He doesn't require the number, whereas the credit card number is required by the acquirer to be able to check with the bank whether the credit limit is okay or not. And so purchase invoice details are not revealed to the acquirer. The bank or the acquirer did not know what customer bought, for which he is paid through credit card. He only has to know the amount for which the payment is made. Amount is the credit card number. Okay. Then what is, you know, you might say it's a privacy concern. As far as the, because what I mean by privacy concern is that if an acquirer knows exactly what all I am purchasing every month and how much I am incurring for those purchases, then it can be used in ways which is not very desirable. Let me take an example what I mean by this. Suppose you go on purchasing a lot of jewelry, okay, and the acquirer knows that you are buying a lot of jewelry at a fair amount of high cost and so on. He can really make that information is made known to many jewelry shops. You end up getting a whole lot of spam messages advertising their wear and stuff like that. And even though it is not ethically correct, many of the acquirers may be selling this information, okay, in order to be able to, you know, and also get a commission on that. There has been a continuous, privacy issues which are involved in this. Many of the Western countries, their privacy laws, if the person kinds of reveals this for even payment or no payment, he is liable to be prosecuted, okay. So, but I think many places it is very lax. These rules are very lax. So that is the reason why one should not make the acquirer know what he has purchased. Of course, the shop must know what is purchasing, because one expects the card, the shop will not reveal. It doesn't know the credit card number, so it will not, it can't reveal who bought what. He only knows somebody bought this much, okay? Because credit card number uniquely identifies the person. So the credit card number, the amount, and what was purchased is available. Then you can actually track down. See, so this is where I think the whole point comes in. That is, the anonymity is preserved by the protocol. So the anonymity, because the shopkeeper knows only what you are buying and how much it is. He doesn't know what your credit card number is. The acquirer knows only your credit card number and how much is the amount. What you purchase, he doesn't know. So this is very important, because that is primarily what said protocol achieves. Purchase invoice plus credit card number is digitally signed by the customer. Okay, so the entire invoice and credit card number, they are signed by the customer using a digital signature. In order to sign, I said that it requires private key. So private key, customer has a private key, use the private key to sign it. So in case of disputes, an arbitrator can use the signature to settle the dispute. That is, I ordered these items, but I wasn't supplied all those items and so on. Then you can have a dispute settlement mechanism, because the signed purchase order is there with the both with the acquirer and with the vendor. Both will have it. That's what we will see in the said protocol. The actual protocol is very complicated, and it runs 262 pages. And frankly, I have not read it, the entire protocol, because it goes into all kinds of programs and so on. But those of you are interested can look at the website of IBM, ibm.com redbook /SG244978, some number SG, there is a document number where the entire protocol will be found. And maybe if you are going to implement it later on in your life, when you work for a company dealing with this kind of financial issues, you may find this reference useful. Okay. In any case, you can go to the IBM website and find out, and ask a question, I want to find out about the secure electronic transaction protocol, and you could get it. But besides that, of course, many codes will not be given, but I think this book has got some code also given, okay, and that will be useful. So the dual, see, the crux of the said protocol is what is known as a dual signature scheme. Dual signature scheme is an innovation of the said protocol, okay, and the steps, there are a number of steps followed by the protocol. Let me explain one by one. And I'll go to the block diagram of the entire transaction, how it takes place, and then recapitulate what all went on, because it is a very complex set of things which happen, and it is not really all that simple. Okay, like the earlier protocol I talked about, this protocol is a little bit more complicated. Now the steps followed by the protocol is, first of all, of course, customer's purchase information has three different parts. One is the purchase order, where all the items are mentioned, and the credit card number, and the amount to be paid. Okay, in fact, the amount to be paid each purchase item, there will be an amount, and the total amount will be the total amount to be paid. Okay, so these are three parts which are there in every purchase order by a customer. The merchant should know the purchase order plus the amount. It need not know the credit card number. The acquirer should know the credit card number plus amount. Okay, so let us call the purchase order plus amount as POA. That is, purchase order plus amount, POA, and the credit card number plus amount as CCA. I will give just abbreviation in order to avoid using the entire long thing every time. And POA is purchase order amount, and CCA is credit card and amount. Hash POA, the purchase order amount with standard hash algorithm and call it POD. The hashing is done primarily for the from the signature point of view. Hash CCA using MD5. Okay, that is the CCA is also along with the customer has got that, see, and call it CCD. Concatenate POD and CCD, call it POD. What is in the concatenation is that the two are stuck together, you might say. These two are strings of bits and these are concatenated. Hash this concatenated stuff giving something called PPD. All of them using the same hashing algorithm. And then PPD is encrypted using the private key of the customer. That's signature. Okay. As we pointed out, the signature is the hashing is actually signed. Okay. This customer's digitally signed purchase order. Okay. So, so digital signature is encrypted PPD, encrypted with the private key, that is PRK, that is private key of the customer. Okay. And this sent to the merchant by the customer. DS is called dual signature as a private key is used to sign two separate digests concatenated together. So you can see here PPD, see we take POA as one and we set CCA as the other. Okay. And then both are hashed and POD is hashed POA and CCD is hashed CCA. And now the two hashed ones concatenated is called PPD. So in other words, all the information which is contained in CCA, in POA, CCA, together signed is, you know, the, before signing actually the digests of both POA and which is actually POD and CCA which is CCD are both concatenated and hashed together. So PPD essentially you might say is that is the reason it is called dual signature because I have got two different items which are being hashed and then encrypted. Okay. And this dual signature is the one which is used for later on dispute resolution and so on. POA is separately encrypted by customer using merchant's public key and sent to the merchant. Because the purchase order and amount, when you strip the purchase order amount, rate card number, the purchase order and amount is encrypted because and sent to the by public key of the vendor. And of course, the customer must have a certification of that vendor. And with certification, it is actually public key is used. Normally what is supposed to be done is that when you log on to a merchant using his URL, you ask for his public key certification and he is supposed to send it back to you. When he sends it back to you, then you know the authentication, you can probably note down the number or whatever is given with that and that will give you the idea about the actual legal entity, that is he is a legal entity. And this is, and of course public key is known and use the public key to separately encrypt the POA, the purchase order amount is encrypted by the public key of the merchant and merchant can now decrypt it using his private key and he gets the purchase order plus amount. CCD and dual signature as well as the concatenated thing, that is the is sent to the merchant. A merchant cannot find CCN from this. Credit card number cannot be found by him. Merchant can decrypt DS using customer's public key and get PPD. Okay, PPD is of course the one which is used as a full digest because this digest is concatenated with two parts. So he can actually verify this, but individual things he cannot verify. Okay, customer must have certified public key for verification, of course. In order to be able to, DS, in order to kind of authenticate the signature, the public key must be certified. Merchant can compute the hash of POD and CCD. If hash of POD and CCD is PPD, then customer signature is okay. In other words, he can find out the hash independently because he has got the purchase order and the hashed GCD. Okay, these two can, he can concatenate himself and then find PPD, and if this is customer signature can be found out. Merchant forwards acquirer CCA, POD and DS is separately encrypted using acquirer's public key. Okay, so digital signature also is sent, because as far as the customer is concerned, he doesn't know anything about the acquirer. He only deals with the vendor. Okay, so vendor has got all these three. Okay, and now the let us just say CCA is credit card number plus amount, and in might say concatenated. In other words, if you kind of we saw that earlier. CCA, the acquirer should really know, because he has already stripped this, and it's actually not available to the merchant, so it's the secrecy is maintained. The merchant forwards acquirer CCA, POD, DC separately encrypted using acquirer's public key. Acquirer forwards it to a bank, of course, in turn. Bank finds CCA and amount, verifies balance amount. Bank also verifies customer's digital signature using CCD, POD and DS. If all okay, acquirer is informed by the bank. And now the transaction, acquirer okays transaction to the merchant. Merchant supplies the item, gets payment from acquirer, bank collects from customer as usual. That is the usual thing. So let us just look at what is really happening here. Okay, with this kind of a customer is breaking up purchase order plus amount, okay, and credit card number plus amount. Okay, he hashes that, gets POD, and hashes this, gets CCD, and concatenates POD and CCD. Okay, that's again hashed, and PPD comes. It is encrypted with private key, and the dual signature comes. Okay, this is how dual signature is generated. Okay, say POD is purchase order plus amount. Purchase order digest, credit card plus amount, credit card amount digest and concatenation, and PPD is purchase payment digest and private key of customer. Okay, that is what has been encrypted, that is digital signature. Okay, so the steps are, of course, customer sends to the merchant all this usual. The merchant sends to acquirer, the acquirer sends to bank, bank gets back to acquirer, acquirer now okays to merchant. Merchant supplies goods, and then the customer gets the bill from the customer. Okay, and of course the acquirer will get also from the bank the amount which is to be collectible, and he will pay in turn the customer. So step one is PO is encrypted with the merchant's public key, CCA encrypted with bank's public key. Okay, and CCD plus DS is sent to the bank, to the merchant. Okay, CCA encrypted, see the point I want to make again is that CCA is not sent as it is. It is encrypted by the bank's public key, which the which cannot be decrypted by the vendor. See, only the bank knows its private key to be able to kind of decrypt this. Okay, so but he has got this in order to be able to prove his later on dispute resolution, and digital signature of course is there. Merchant sends CCA plus DS plus POD to acquirer, acquirer sends CCA and so on. I think I'll probably repeat this next time, because I went through it a little fast, and these are the steps that are important to remember, and so I'll repeat this next time, and we'll look at this transaction using that little block diagram, and explain this in greater detail. Okay, so we'll see you next time.